Kim, what's on your radar?
Well, the school shooter who killed four students and seriously wounded others in Detroit on Tuesday has been named. 15-year-old Ethan Crumbley used a semi-automatic pistol to do nothing short of hunt his peers. The four who have been tragically killed are 14-year-old Hannah St. Juliana, 16-year-old Tate Meyer, 17-year-olds Madison Baldwin and Justin Schilling. Six other students and one teacher have been hospitalized with various gunshot wounds to the chest, legs, shoulders, hips, and even a couple of students who were shot in the neck and one in the jaw. The motive is unknown, but preliminary reports are that this is another case of a loner kid who kept to himself, was bitter towards his peers, or even possibly bullied by them. He wore all black, he played Minecraft, and the people who knew him, like his half-brother and other students, were shocked to discover he was the person behind these monstrous attacks. Crumbley is being charged as an adult. He is currently facing 4 counts of first-degree murder, 7 counts of assault with an intent to murder, 12 counts of possession of a firearm in the commission of a felony, and 1 count of terrorism causing death. And I want to take a moment and focus in on that last charge of terrorism, because it was, as we pointed out on the show yesterday, this shooting could be used as an opportunity to address some real issues our country is facing concerning gun laws. Yet instead, this shooting is likely going to be used to politicize and demonize, quite frankly, white people and Trump supporters instead. Now, first of all, the charge of terrorism is no doubt going to be exploited all over the news and social media without any real explanation as to what the charge actually means. It often has nothing to do with what you and I associate terrorism with. A charge of terrorism often means you have caused people to feel terror, terror that may leave them feeling paranoid and traumatized. County Prosecutor Karen McDonald said this about the terrorism charge against Crumbley. What about all the children who ran screaming, hiding under desks? What about all the children at home who can't eat and can't sleep and can't imagine a world where they could ever step foot back in that school? The purpose of this particular charge is to bring justice to those who maybe weren't shot, but who are suffering emotional trauma from the events, people who are terrorized. It's not the same as domestic terrorism or foreign ISIS-style terrorism that requires a political motive. But my guess is we can expect this isn't going to be overtly explained in the news. They'll say he's been charged with terrorism, and rather than explain the nuance in the meaning, they will then turn the conversation towards the growing threat of domestic white terrorism in America and leave the audience to think this attack was motivated by Republicans who support Donald Trump. And why do I think this? Because it's already being done. Look at this tweet from Keith Olbermann. This kid died to stop a school shooter whose mother echoed the Trumpist fascism of Stool Presidente and Barstool Sports. Keith Olbermann cites an article by the Daily Beast that claims though Crumbley's father's social media posts weren't political, his mother penned an open letter on her blog to Donald Trump after he won the election in 2016. In the post, she appreciated Trump being a bad public speaker, saying it showed sincerity and humility. She said she didn't care about his tax returns and whether or not he did or did not pay some taxes, because the fact the government can even lock people up over not paying them is corrupt in and of itself. She said she hoped Trump would really uncover the politicians for what she believed they really are and hoped they might shut down Big Pharma, make healthcare affordable for her and her middle-class family again. She said she supported the border wall and thanked him for allowing her the right to bear arms, that as a realtor who shows homes to people, she appreciated the ability to protect herself. The fact the media is even bringing up Crumbley's mother's political affiliation shows us where they're headed with this. Rather than focus on how this 15-year-old was able to gain access to a weapon and focus on making changes to our gun laws, such as requiring ammunition to be locked away separately from firearms or laws that hold the registered gun owner responsible, we're going to use this event to demonize Trump voters, amplify this idea that white domestic terrorism is the country's greatest threat, and somehow devolve this into a race war by saying if he were any other color than white, he'd be dead, which is not true. The man who drove his car into a Christmas parade and killed numerous people is not white and not dead. And further evidence of this, look at the photos of Ethan Crumbley people on social media and some media outlets are using. He's now 15, and yet they chose this angelic-looking photo from about when he was 10. What is the purpose of this when there are several other photos, like his mugshot, that could have been shown instead? This same sort of tactic is used in reverse against black perpetrators and even victims. Rather than use their school photo of them smiling and looking like good kids, they use the meanest looking, most aggressive photo they can find on social media to portray them as villains. They attempt to portray them as people who either obviously would commit the heinous crime they did or victims who deserved it. They do this to placate a certain bias and mindset that the audience already holds, and the same looks to be happening in this case. Showing Crumbley as this innocent-looking angelic white kid is intended to stoke fear and support a narrative that white people, no matter how nice they look, are domestic terrorists who we should all be afraid of. They are catering this message to a group of people in this country who already possess this belief. It's divisive and it's inaccurate in both scenarios. Rather than try to correct the wrongs and harms that have happened against one group, many in the nation seem more inclined toward evening the score and enacting revenge instead. This isn't healthy and this isn't helpful. The fact is, Ethan Crumbley took innocent lives and maimed others, and his motive is still unknown. And even if it comes out that he has a political affiliation or another, the only thing that matters is why he committed this crime in particular. The last thing we should do is paint an entire cohort of people as evil or people we should fear because they happen to share the same characteristic or belief. We have issues with our gun laws that have nothing to do with whether or not you should have the right to own certain firearms. Common sense laws, like locking up the ammo separately from the firearm itself, holding people accountable who buy weapons and recklessly store them or allow others who are not registered to the weapon to have access to it. Our goal needs to be to save lives. So let's keep our eye on the ball. So I think this is going to be another case, kind of like Kyle Rittenhouse, where now, look, this guy's guilty. I think it's really obvious from all the evidence that we're seeing that this guy is very, very guilty, very different than the Kyle Rittenhouse case as far as the actual facts. But how they'll use it to fuel a narrative or a discussion or to demonize others. This isn't about Ethan Crumbley. Whether or not people want to call him a terrorist, that has nothing to do with him. It really has to do with this narrative that we're facing this white domestic terrorism in this country. This is our big problem, and we've got to do something to stop it. And that stopping it has nothing to do with Ethan Crumbley. It will affect other people, and that is what I'm most afraid of on this.
Yeah. When they use the phrase white domestic terrorism, so terrorism has become such a slippery term and ought to just be retired entirely, probably even when we're talking about ISIS and other things, because, you know, trying to ascribe coherent ideology or motivations to people who commit mass murder is a tricky game, because people who commit violence and murder are often deranged or in some way deranged. So you're like trying to make sense of something that doesn't actually make sense. That's particularly clear in cases like this. Like, what is his ideology? He doesn't really have one. And then we go looking for one because we want to find someone to blame and we want it to all make sense. But it doesn't, because violence is random and frightening and not explained by obvious, like, well, this person thought this, they read this, they came to this conclusion, and thus they did this. It doesn't work like that.
What's also interesting in this situation is I covered the race of the prosecutor, the campaign of the prosecutor, Karen McDonald. She ran as a reformist, a criminal justice reformer. Who knocked off the former kind of hardline, tough-on-crime prosecutor, this woman named Jessica Cooper, who'd been there for many years, and ran, saying that, only prosecutors can reform a broken system. She previously had worked in the foster care system, so she, has a lot of, understanding of the way that, young people interact with the criminal justice system. And so maybe I shouldn't have been, but I was surprised to see her charge him as an adult out of the gate, despite him being only 15 years old. And so it raises the question of what does the criminal justice reform movement mean when it is, making a lot of the claims that it's making on the campaign trail, if when they get into office, they go about their charging decisions, roughly how Jessica Cooper would have.
Well, and the terrorism charge is really suspect, because even though it definitely fits this crime, it's not a typical charge that they put really for anyone else. I don't know if the other mass school shooters or mass shooters in general have ever been charged with terrorism. And it's almost like this auxiliary charge to put on him in order to continue fueling a narrative or to rile people up. And that is concerning, even though I do think it fits. It's just that's not what people interpret it as.
He's going to go to prison for years and years and years, decades, hopefully maybe the rest
forever.
Of his life, whether or not there's a terrorism charge. So, but we will be back with more Rising right after this. Stay with us.